you're a heavy metal fan and go and see Iron Maiden 1 week, and you happen to want to see Adamant the next week, you'd have to go in disguise because it's really uncool, you know. Whereas 10 years ago, you could go and see Jethro Tull 1 week and quite happily see Mark Bolan a couple of weeks later, and it would still be accepted as part of the same broad spectrum of rock. Whereas now, it's not at all. I mean, I can't think of a clearer parallel between Mark Bolan and Adamant, and yet it's conceived in a different world altogether now. I think the whole point's being lost about music. The reason rock was so strong and it was called rock through many transitions, it started off very simply with guitar-based groups doing a modern impersonation of either country, western or blues, or a cheap imitation of Elvis Presley or Little Richard. And as time went on, more and more influences became absorbed in the music. And then various major steps, I mean, the inclusion of keyboard players who then brought in the influences. These are guys who'd been trained in classical music or had great jazz influence, and that came into rock and became part of it, and you could see the influence. It's when perhaps musicians started thinking a little bit more, they became more adept at their craft as well as the art side of it, and the quality improved so much that everywhere you looked there were bands full of immense talent. I mean, coming from different fields, folk. I mean, Jethro Tull, sort of, I mean, where do you put that? Where does that come from? You know, pixie rock, you know. And then you had bands like Nice, which were very sort of classically influenced. Free, which was soul and blues and that sort of stuff. And the Eccentrics, you know, all around the fringes. That just doesn't exist anymore. I think heavy metal is just an empty shell, really. I don't want any part of it.
Sure. You obviously don't describe Deep Purple as a heavy metal band. I mean, you were described as that on the radio I noticed this morning.
Well, I think a lot of people who present music get conned by their own tricks, really. The thing is that it'd be nice now and again to be afforded the privilege that soloists get, and that is that if you're a group, everyone seems uncomfortable unless they put you in a category, unless they put you in a bag, you know, you're this kind of group or that kind of group. But when five people, or four people, or however many it may be, become so compatible that they can actually produce a sound which is identifiable, and it's very obvious who it is when you hear it on the radio, then to me that's the same sort of thing as listening to a soloist, because five become one, and you may move in many different directions over the years musically. Things that are happening around you will influence you. So, I mean, I don't see why Deep Purple can't be just allowed the freedom that, say, David Bowie gets or something like that.
Well, let's move to the band now. We obviously haven't asked you, you know, why the reunion? And you all had your own individual offshoot areas.
Yeah, I think for 10 years we've all been trying to achieve, without knowing it, what we already had with Deep Purple. We're all perhaps too proud. We're all quite volatile. And I don't think in a million years, if you had some sort of analyst examine our characters, would even imagine that it would last more than a day, this band. But there's some strange chemistry that makes it work.